Topic about prescribing spectacles in children. Is this really way different from adults? All of us are doing adult refraction for years together. So why this particular topic for a lecture? So what are the differences that are there between the pediatric refraction and the adult refraction? Is number one is inability to accurately determine the child's visual acuity. So though we have a host of charts to really try and pen down a child's vision, still it's not entirely accurate to really know what would be that child's visual acuity. A child has lesser visual demands as compared to the adults. Proximity of working distance. So basically a child's world is quite based on a near work vision, a near vision, at least till one and a half to 2 years of age. So this point needs to be taken into consideration when we are actually refracting the infants. And plasticity of the visual cortex. So their brain is constantly developing and can get adjusted to new stimuli. So that is also very important. So what are the points that we need to consider while prescribing glasses to children? Number one, is the refractive error within the normal range for the child's age? So what do we mean by that? For a particular age, certain refractive errors may be absolutely normal. And in that case, that particular child does not need a pair of glasses. Number two, will this particular child's refractive error emetropize? So what do we understand by emetropize? Is basically the eyeball is undergoing certain changes wherein the refractive power of the eye undergoes changes because the axial length changes, the corneal curvature changes, and the power goes on decreasing or going towards normal. The power gets autocorrected going towards normal. Will this level of refractive error disrupt normal visual development or the existing functional vision? So are we actually helping the child by giving that pair of glass, or are we causing more damage? So functional vision, why I have put this word as functional vision? So there would be a subset of children who may not have a very normal visual acuity, like say for example, children who are neurologically impaired. So basically, functional vision refers to how a child is performing visually in his or her surroundings, which may be way different from the Snellen's visual acuity that we record in the clinic. So this is especially important for children who are not able to really read a Snellen's chart or the neurologically impaired, where we do a functional vision assessment to actually gauge their performance in. Vision, will prescribing glasses actually interfere with the normal process of emetropization? So are we really doing more harm over here? Because otherwise that refractive error would have got corrected with age. But because we have done an intervention, we have actually interfered with that growth process. So keeping these points in mind, let us go to some case scenarios wherein we can try and discuss as to what pair of glasses that this particular child needs to be given. So starting with case number one, this is a 4-year-old male child who had a history of cracker injury. The child was operated for a traumatic cataract. The vision in the right eye, that is the operated eye, is 6/24 with a correction of +1 spherical with -2 cylinder at 90 degree. The child is improving to 6/12. The unaided near vision is N24, and with the +3 add, the child is improving to N6. That is normal with no significant fracture. So that's question number one. That's mainly for the distance. And number two, is should the child be given a near add for the right eye? Okay, so this particular child, we will give a full prescription. So what I mean by full prescription is we will give him the hypermetropic add also that was there for distance, the +1, which otherwise we may not want to give a normal 4-year-old child who has a good accommodative effort. And near add is extremely important for this child because this could be a factor for development of amblyopia, because a child will not be binocular for near vision if the near correction is not given to that particular child for that eye. Moving on to case number two, a 3-year-old child who was born prematurely comes into the clinic for a routine eye checkup. The child is not cooperative for a formal vision assessment. The child was orthophoric, there was no squint, And this is the retinoscopy bar. The cyclopegic retinoscopy reveals the refraction of plus 3 diopter sphere with plus 1 at 90 degrees. So this is what probably you would get as a dilated autorefractive reading. Now, should this particular child be prescribed glasses? Well, the answer is no, because this particular refractive error of plus 3 with plus 1 at 90 degrees.
There was error at, I think, Prachi's place.
Okay.
We'll just wait for 2 minutes. Prachi, there's some internet lag at your place. Did I experience it or everybody experienced it?
No. We all experienced it, yes.
Oh, everybody experienced it.
Okay.
Okay, you have stopped.
Maybe you can
screen share. Can you share your screen
again? Screen.
You want me to share the screen again?
Again, yes.
Yes.
It's showing me internet now.
Yeah.
You were at the second chat with the.
Yeah.
Not this one, the previous one.
That's the same thing going on.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah?
You can restart from here.
Okay, so case number 2, a 3-year-old child who was a prematurely born child comes in the clinic for a routine eye checkup. The child was not cooperative for a formal vision assessment. However, the child was orthophoric, and this is the crossbar of the cyclopegic retinoscopy, which reveals a reading of plus 3 with diopter sphere with plus 1. So generally the answer is no, because this level of refractive error is perfectly okay for this age. Hyperopia of more than 4 diopters and astigmatism of more than 2 diopters is what is significant for this age group. So this child just requires observation and a repeat cyclopegic refraction after 4 to 6 months to see whether the hypermetropia and the cylinder are tending to go down. Case number 3, a 3-year-old child presents to the clinic with intermittent esotropia. Now, this child turned out to be pretty cooperative for vision assessment, and the visual acuity is actually normal, 6x6. The cyclopegic retinoscopy is absolutely similar to the previous case, wherein we get a cyclopegic retinoscopy of plus 3 diopter sphere with plus 1 cylinder at 90 degrees. Now, what do we do in this scenario, wherein we have a similar child, but with an esotropia, with a convergent squint? So the question is, do we give the child a pair of glasses? If yes, do you want to give the full correction or do we undercorrect? So this particular child deserves a full prescription of plus glasses because the child has esotropia. So this particular child was given the full correction and his squint was completely okay. So this was a case of refractive accommodative esotropia. So whenever there is a case of esotropia with a significant plus, which is significant, we can say is more than plus 1.5, we have to give a trial of the full cyclopegic refraction to see what effect it has on the esotropia. So just a small poem on hyperopia. It's not made by me. I've taken it from somewhere. Lucky hyperopic lasses, chances are they'll not need glasses unless there is a little hint of an accommodative. Unless it is very, very significant, because they have very good accommodative effort and a small amount of. On to case number 4. A 7-year-old child is using glasses since 4 years. The current pair of glasses that a child is using is on the right eye, it has a power of minus 5 diopter sphere, and the left eye has a spherical correction of minus 2.5. Now, the child's vision with the glasses that the child is using is 6x24 on the right eye with N6, and on the left eye is 6x6 N6. So the child has some subnormal vision on the right eye, even with the glasses on. So refraction is repeated And we get to know that the child has actually a more myopic correction of minus 7. And the child is in fact improving with that correction to 6.9. And the left eye is well refracted, minus 2.5. So here we have a situation of anisomyopia, where the myopia in the right eye is way more than that is there in the left eye. So few questions that we need to answer over here is, what would be the amount of induced anisokonia? So anisokonia is nothing but the retinal image size disparity that is there on the that is there because of the difference in the refractive error. Should we undercorrect in view of the induced anisokonia? Well, let me get you to certain rules here, because that's what really going to teach us as to how do we go about in such a case scenario. With anisometropia is primarily of refractive origin, the anisokonia produced will be about 1.5% per diopter of anisometropia. But since the anisometropia may be partly axial, an estimate of 1% per diopter is more useful. Slightly confusing, but let us just keep a bit of this in mind, that anisokonia can induce a bit of anisometropia can induce an anisokonia, which is significant. So a difference of one diopter causes a 2% difference in the size of the retinal images. A difference of up to 5% is well tolerated. So with this math, anisometropia of up to 2.5 diopters is well tolerated. Between 2.5 and 4 diopters is tolerated depending on individual sensitivity, and more than 4 diopters is not tolerated. So keeping this rule in mind, probably that child was prescribed minus 5 on the right eye when the refractive error on the left eye was minus 2.5. Now, the thing is, what we really need to do is we should not just undercorrect keeping this rule in mind. Because the child's vision is improving well with the full correction, give the child a full correction and check for diplopia, whether the child is really having double vision with that full correction. Don't assume that the child will have anisokonia and hence diplopia. So put the full correction in place and do a worth for dot test to really check whether the child is having double vision. Also get an axial length measurement done and a keratometry reading done. Why we are coming to it? So if the child has binocular single vision with full prescription, it should be prescribed. And do not, there's something missing. Okay. So if the child has binocular single vision with full prescription, it should be prescribed. Do not empirically undercorrect, assuming that this child will end up having diplopia. Now, why am I saying this? Is because anisometropia can be because of difference in the axial length as well as refractive change. That brings us here to another rule, which is called as the NAPS rule. So if anisometropia is entirely axial and the corrective spectacles are placed in the anterior focal plane, the size of the retinal image would be identical to that formed in an emetropic eye, that is the same as the eye of the same refractive power. So what we understand over here is that basically if the anisometropia is of axial origin, then there is generally no anisokonia. However, if it is of refractive origin because of the changes in the corneal curvature or because of the changes in the lens, then anisokonia is much more. That's the reason why we should not just undercorrect these patients without doing this workup of putting the full correction, checking for diplopia, getting their axial length and keratometry measure. So just for some fun again, it's true that anisokonia is less lethal than pneumonia, especially the COVID one, I guess. Doctors, nonetheless, if choosing, would find pneumonia less confusing. So anisokonia is a slightly gray area which needs to be worked up a little more. Moving on to case number 5, a 15-month male child with mother suspecting squinting of eyes. On examination, the child's rating acuity measured binocularly was okay, 8 cycles per minute. Child had pseudo-squint in the form of epicanthal folds. So cycloplegic refraction done on this child revealed a cylinder of minus 4.5 diopters at 180 degrees. Rest anterior and posterior segment was normal. So this is a 1.5-year-old child approximately. So now, what do we do here? Should we? And how much should we? If yes, how much should we prescribe? Well, astigmatism of more than 3 diopters is significant in this age group. Okay. However, it is recommended that we give a partial correction in the younger children. So you would want to give probably just half of the cylindrical correction that we have got, because cylindrical corrections are known to decrease over a period of time. This is because basically in the infant eye, the corneal curvatures are very, very steep. Especially in the first 2 years, there's a significant amount of flattening that happens, because of which the cylindrical corrections can go down. Also, when you're giving a partial correction, you're leaving some stimulus for emetropization. So what we said is the changes that are happening in the eye to go towards the normal power is you're leaving something behind for the eye to just act. Moving on to case number 6, a 4-year-old child presenting with a small head tilt. Orthoptic evaluation was okay. There was no evident strabismus, no nystagmus. Cycloplegic refraction in the right eye shows a cylinder of 0.75 at 180. And in the left eye shows a cylinder of -1.5 at 50 degree. Fundus is normal. Now again, should we prescribe or observe? This is just a 4-year-old child. Look at the cylindrical powers. Well, for this particular child, we need to give a pair of glasses. Just with a pair of glasses, in fact, the head posture of this child was completely corrected. Now, why do we need to give this particular child a pair of glasses? Is because the child has oblique astigmatism. So if you noted the axis on the left eye, it was 50 degrees. So oblique astigmatism is more prone for meridional amblyopia. And also this particular child had an abnormal head posture. So meridional amblyopia, we should keep in mind that we need to correct even the lower amounts. So margin of error. So basically the cylindrical power. So what do you mean by margin of error? So suppose you get the glasses made, you have prescribed, say for example, 180 degrees, and the glass comes out to while checking the power, it is like 175 degrees. And is it really okay or is it not okay? Is what this is telling us. So if it is a 0.5 cylinder, it is okay to have it within plus or minus 7 degrees. If it is 0.75 diopters within plus and minus 5 degrees, between 0.75 to 1.5 within plus or minus 3 degrees, and greater cylinders within plus or minus 2 degrees. So the higher the cylinder, care should be taken more accurately. The glass has to be made. If the glass is off axis, the child will not accept that pair of glass. And in fact, we'll probably do end up doing more harm than good. So just again, for some fun, to an uncorrected astigmat, some girls are round and others are flat. With glasses, it is likely that the round are thin and the flat are fat. Okay. So moving on to case number 7, 8-year-old child presenting with headache and some asthenopia on doing near work. The visual acuity is okay, 6-6, N6 on either eye. Orthoptic workup reveals an exophoria for near of 10 diopters and for distance of 5 diopters. The near point of convergence is receded to 14 centimeters. So let me just tell you, the normal is around 8 centimeters. Fusional amplitude. So what is positive fusional amplitude? It is the ability of the child to converge and maintain that convergence. That's what we call as a positive fusional amplitude. So that was 16 diopters for near. And negative fusional amplitude is the ability to lighten that, which was 10 diopters. Cycloplegic retinoscopy in this child revealed a refractive error of -0.5 diopter sphere. Now, the child has exophoria, the child has convergence insufficiency, and that small refractive error of -0.5 is going to help the child to converge and see better and control the squint and reduce the asthenopic symptoms. You can obviously add the convergence exercises along with these glasses. So that was the last case. So let me just summarize. For astigmatism, so these are few age-wise nomenclatures which I have mentioned. More than 2.5 diopters at 15 months of age, we need to give partial correction. More than 2 diopters at 2 years of age upwards, again give partial correction for a year, year and a half. More than 1.5 at 4 year upwards, full correction. Rarely partial correction for adaptation, but I don't really believe that. So more than 1 or 1.5. So current thing is now 1, I think, as per the recent IGO article. more than one diopter of oblique astigmatism more than 1 year upwards. So we really need to be very careful about the oblique astigmatism. So even in the very young kids, if the axis is weird, we need to really get that right. Correct 3-4 till age of 2 and then full correction. More than 0.75 diopter at school age, so 5 years and up. Myopia 0 to 1 year more than minus 5, only if the myopia is to such a high extent, we really need to give glasses. Again, undercorrect by 2 diopters because the child has a proximity of working distance and the child has just a small area of field to work in. 1 to 2 years more than minus 4, undercorrect by 1 to 2 diopters. 2 to 3 years more than minus 3 and undercorrect by a diopter. 4 year upwards, anything more than 0.75, you need to give full correction. So for hypermetropia, between 0 to 1 year, more than plus 6. 1 to 2 years more than plus 5. 2 to 3 more than plus 4. So look at the amount of hyperopia which is really okay for this. So even 4 years and upwards, more than plus 2.5. School age, more than plus 1.5. Full correction may be given, but you really need to titrate by looking by doing a fogging test and look at their accommodation. Anisometropia, myopia between 0 to 2 years, more than minus 2.5. 2 to 3 years, more than minus 2. And hypermetropia in younger age group of around 2 to 2.5 is significant. 2 to 3 years and upwards, more than 1.5 is significant. And astigmatism, as I mentioned, so more than 1.5 to 2 diopters is significant. So these are numbers which are actually there in the charts. We don't really need to buy hard these. So take home messages. Unilateral pseudopic should be prescribed a near ad and as well as the full hypermetropic ad, irrespective of their age. In a child with esotropia, any hypermetropia of more than plus 1.5 diopters should be fully prescribed. Anisometropia, which is purely of axial origin, will not cause diplopia and should be fully prescribed. Oblique astigmatism of more than one diopter needs to be fully prescribed. In patients with convergence insufficiency, small myopia of even minus 0.5 diopters is significant and should be prescribed. Thank you.
Thank you, Prachi. That was a wonderful presentation. A lot of take-home messages and pointers. Any of the moderators can take over.
Yeah, Prachi, that was very well sort of summarized. I think I wanted to just start the discussion maybe a little bit, and then we can take on some of the questions that came from the participants themselves. Maybe we'll take the participant question first. There was one doctor who asked, where can we get these numbers quite easily? And I think the AAO guidelines are there and that. Any other sources you have, Prachi?
I would say the IGO article by Dr. Sumit Monga in 2018. So that's okay. The Indian data. So just that has a chart. You can just take a printout or write it out.
Yeah, so it is good to have that in your, you know, clinic, and so that you, until you can memorize those numbers so that you know which to prescribe. And there was another question from the participant. Dr. Rajan asked, in case number 3, I think that was your esotropia case where we prescribed the full cyclopegic refraction. He wanted to know whether AC by A ratio should have been measured in that case.
So generally, it's a good idea to put in the full plus correction and then measure the AC by A ratio. Because unless you have given the full hypermetropic correction, it may be slightly difficult to really estimate it. So what we can do is actually call the child back for a PMT after 3 days, put in the full correction that you've got on the cycloplegic refraction, repeat a cover test for near and distance with whatever, plus C or minus C, and then estimate the AC by A ratio.
I think in
but
that
the
case,
fully accommodative ones also, yeah. When you cycloplege and put the correction, you can see that their eyes are completely straight actually.
Actually, to begin with, I think this child had a similar esotropia for near and distance, yeah. Even before you refracted him. Right. So really, there was no reason to suspect any indication of, you know, a more, you know, hyperconvergence or anything where we would consider bifocals. So in a situation like this, I wouldn't actually measure AC by a ratio. I would go ahead and prescribe the full prescription, full plus, and not call them for PMT or anything. Let them come back, get into their glasses, and then remeasure them. And at that stage, if you find that the near angle is more or something, that is a stage to, you know, consider bifocals or to take on this. I think there are some more questions.
Hi, Dr. Prachi. Himlata, your excellent presentation. There's one question, like, how would you prescribe when there's an exotropia and a hyperopia? What are the guidelines?
Yeah. So the consensus is, if the hypermetropia is significant, okay, you might want to undercorrect, but you give the correction that gives the best vision. Because when vision improves, that can act as a stimulus for fusion. So it depends what kind of exotropia you're looking at. But giving the best visual acuity is definitely a factor for enabling fusion. So it's not that if there is exotropia and there is significant amount of hypermetropia, you don't correct the child. That's not correct. So there's a significant amount of hypermetropia. You need to correct that to allow the child to get the best possible vision, child or adult, whatever.
So there's one question. Go ahead, Himlata. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, I'm just trying to read the questions.
Another question is, like, in if a child has a significant cylinder, when do you do a baseline topography and tachymetry, and how often do you repeat it?
Yeah. Okay. So there are various reports regarding that. So some people, so in practice, actually, if it is a cylinder of more than 2.5 to 3 diopters, that's the time I actually get a topography done, a baseline topography. And if the refractive error is really not changing at all, then I really don't tend to repeat the topography. However, if I find that the cylindrical error is on the rise or there is a change in the refractive error, then I really repeat the topography. But I mean, there are reports and presentations of even more than one diopter cylinder, 1.5 diopter cylinder to really get a topography done. But in practice, I really get it done for 2.5 diopters and up. I don't know if anybody else is doing it differently. Maybe you could just add on.
I think Dr. Karobi wanted to say something. Sapnesh, can you unmute?
Dr. Karobi, you have to unmute.
Yeah.
Yes.
Dr. Karobi, go ahead. You were saying something, madam?
That was a very nice presentation, very peppy one, with all those fillers in between. I just had a question for you. Is that the second case where you showed that the child had a refractive error of plus 3 with a one cylinder at whatever axis? Suppose this had been a special child, would you have given or wouldn't you have given?
Yeah, so ma'am, if I didn't include cases of special kids here. So if it was a special kid with a developmental delay and we are suspecting cortical visual impairment, I would call back the child to reassess the accommodation. And do a dynamic retinoscopy to really see whether there is an accommodative lag. Only if there is an accommodative lag that I really pick up, only then will I prescribe the child glasses, not otherwise.
I agree.
Another thing which I wanted to say is that in these children, what we have found is that their global improvements occur even if it is a small cylindrical value which has to be prescribed, because that also makes a lot of difference in their general makeup, you know. So I feel this is a special category of children which has to have different norms as compared to the normal refractive errors that you get in normal children. And the prescriptions of even small cylinders is very helpful in their global development. We've got so many children who improve with the glasses, you know. Especially the autistics and the ones which have the ADHD, a lot of changes in their behaviors and their developments do occur following just giving glasses.
Agree.
Dr. Shivram, do you what sort of cylindrical power, minimum power you would prescribe, say in a child who's maybe 3 years old? 4 years old.
No. What Prachi has said is absolutely, I have got no variation from what she has said. I was nodding my head all the time.
Hi, Shivram. How are you?
I'm good, thanks.
So there was another...
We'll have to ask Shivram, what do they do in Australia?
Nothing special.
So good to know they're doing the same like us.
They don't use atropine at all. The only thing is that you do not use atropine at all for the cyclopegic refraction. They only use cyclopentolate because the effect of atropine is for so long, and the photophobia and whatever side effects of atropine they're pretty scared of. Number two, most of the kids have got light eyes. If they're dark, there are a lot of dark-eyed kids. There's no question about it due to the immigration. But for that, we use cyclopentolate twice rather than once. But that's about it.
Achi, can I just bring up the discussion of case 4, which was your anisometropic myope patient that we spoke about anisocornea. A lot of these anisometropes, especially the hyperopes, you know, they tend to have a very poor vision in the eye that has the higher refractive error. So in this situation, usually the vision is so low that one does not have any fusional mechanism to get diplopia. And so in these situations, you can safely prescribe a large difference in the refractive error without worrying about diplopia. Is that something you would agree with? Or?
So yes, so when actually the question of diplopia really arises mainly when the vision tends to improve very.
Yes. So you know how you said... Sorry, go ahead.
No, you said...
You know how you said the NAPS rule in which, you know, axial length... I'm just playing devil's advocate. Please correct me if I'm wrong. That when you are placing a concave lens of a high power, like -9, say, it is the concave lens that is minifying the image when you have worn it. And that if your retina is got a resolution good enough and you've got the fusional mechanism, then you should get anisocornea. So the fact that the patient may have an axial myopia is not as important there, because the minification is taking place due to a refractive surface that is the concave lens.
No.
Am I wrong?
The myopia is axial, the image size will be equal when you put a -9 glass in front of that eye. So that's the whole idea. That was the whole idea of presenting this case. So even in aphakia or whatever, wherever we get high plus lenses because of a refractive origin, the glasses just don't work at all. That's the reason we actually advocate contact lenses to, reduce the whatever, anisocornea. So that's why I said when the problem is more of being refractive in origin because of the cornea or the lens, that's the time that, you really need to think about not giving the full correction of glasses or giving something else which can reduce the magnification or minification induced by the glasses.
So if you do get the diplopia, you would go ahead with contact lens. Would that be something you
consider? We can try contact lenses, yes. But frankly, there are a subset of patients where there is a small vertical squint actually, because of which they have diplopia. Not again because of the difference in the power.
Right.
A small vertical
disruption. And there is one question as what age would you like to consider contact lenses? Does it vary from child to child or any?
Yes, it would vary from case to case, because aphakic children, we are giving contact lenses right from the age of 2 months, 3 months. So I don't think really age is a big criteria. We need to evaluate it on a case to case basis, I would say.
Basically, the child should be able to take care of the lenses, the hygiene part, removing, inserting.
That's for the older age group. So if we are talking of the child not wanting to wear a pair of glasses and substitute it with contact lenses, I would say 12 years and up, just because they don't want to wear a pair of glasses. But functional use of contact lenses, like as we are giving an aphakia or an anisomyopes, as we were discussing just before this, it could be any age, even a 2-year-old child, 3-year-old child, if required, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Ashwin,
just a comment. Yes, please.
Oh, it's very rare to have pure axial myopia. There'll always be some refractive component, and that's why anisocoria is always there. Plus, as Prachi said, they may or may not be tropia, a microtropia, but usually there is sort of usually some sort of foveal dislocation, you can say, so that there is
some suppression.
That is the other, yeah. So the microtropias or the foveal disparity, fixation disparity sort of picture, then that gives rise to the diplopia rather than the actual spectacle prescription. That's what Prachi was alluding to earlier.
Right. What about Shivram? What about the practice of undercorrecting an astigmatism by almost half, like Prachi said, in case 5? Is that something you would do, or would you be closer to the full astigmatism, even if it's a high one? Yes.
In a small child, 1 to 2 year old age group.
So yes. Again, I would go with what I agree with what Prachi says, and it would be on a case to case basis. But a younger child, undercorrect; the older the child, full correct.
And is that because you want emetropization to take place, or is that because they cannot adjust to a higher?
Both, a combination of both. Emetropization also, and again, go by the visual requirement. Why do you need to correct a full 4 diopters in a 2 year old? His world is not that great anyway.
Because I believe that he's using his circle of least diffusion. Why should he use that? He should get both the images of both the axes to fall straight on the retina. Why not give him that benefit?
You mean full correction in a younger child?
Yes. I mean, yes.
I agree that there is a school of thought for that. That's what I said. I personally don't do that, but I agree with you. There is a school of thought for that. So you can give the full correction. And there is a school of thought which in fact says that if you do not give the full correction, then the emetropization is less likely to happen. Again, there's some optometry.
Because no amount of accommodation can correct an astigmatism.
It's not a question of accommodation.
Not accommodation. It is that the corneal curvatures, they sort of readjust themselves. I've seen astigmatisms. I mean, if you do refraction in all kids, in my practice at least, I used to have kids of the age of up to 2 years always have astigmatism about 0.75 diopters at 70 and 110 in both eyes. And 1 year down the line or 1.5 years down the line, that would disappear. 50% of my kids used to have that. So the cornea does go remolding.
Yeah, would not remold if you gave a full prescription? That's my question.
I'm not sure. I don't know. I don't have enough data for that.
Siddharth, what do you have? Do you have a comment on this, Siddharth?
Yeah. So finally, okay.
No. You had the option of speaking without being invited to speak, Siddharth.
No. That's
we
okay.
All know that.
No. It's okay.
Siddharth doesn't require invitation to speak.
My path
nitya to chhodega nahi usko.
I am saying that before the age of 3 years, when emetropization is still going on, defocus actually pushes the eye towards normalcy. This is shown by a few studies. Now, there are schools of thoughts, as you said, but you shouldn't. The entire prescription in pediatric ophthalmology is the consensus based. So all these tables are also because 50% of the people agree on something. That's why those numbers come there. Otherwise, neither you nor Shivram nor Prachi is wrong. Everybody is right.
You need to pick a side, Siddharth, actually.
Okay. So, up to the age of 3 years, I do undercorrect a little bit. And up to the...
How much? Like?
That's arbitrary. Totally.
Oh, okay.
There is no...
But would you go to half the prescription?
No. It's arbitrary in the sense, suppose I have a 3-diopter cylinder, I'll give 2.
Yeah.
Okay. If it is less than 3 years of age, if it is less more than 3 years of age, I will give the full correction because the maximum emetropization process is over. So at that point, you have to balance three things, whether emetropization is there or not, whether the residual that you are leaving behind will affect if the person's vision, the visual need and the amblyopia potential. So that's how you decide on that. Plus, as Shivram say, a lot of astigmatism in childhood up to age of 2 years is transient. and so is anisometropia. Transient anisometropia up to 3 diopter is known. So even if you see anisometropia of minus 2.5, minus 3 up to the age of 3 years, you would rather wait for 4 months before you prescribe to see if it is changing or not. Because that changes pretty rapidly. So if at the age of 1 year, suppose you say minus 2.5 diopters of anisometropia, you would rather wait for 4 to 6 months to actually see whether it's staying or going away, because that is also very transient in nature. Plus, one comment about the AAO tables. To my liking, they are a little bit on the higher side. I usually reduce the spheres by one and the cylinders by half, and then I start liking them a lot more than I would otherwise.
Yeah, so it's all about consensus.
It is all about consensus. There is very, very few things. If you undercorrect by one, I undercorrect by half. Both of us are right.
Yes. At least nobody is wrong.
One question. This is about the spectacle material. Do these blue cut lenses really help? That's one question one of the participants wanted to know.
Can someone first explain what is blue cut lenses?
Basically, which cuts the UV light.
Blue block.
The UV, blue UV, blockers. the blue block. Color is block. Yes.
Blue filter. Yeah.
I don't personally use it, advocate them, but I don't know. I don't
know. I feel that you are finally, what is happening to the children who are not wearing glasses? What's happening to them?
True, but the companies say that they should also wear zero number blue blockers.
Yes, yes. See, the whole then if idea you are prescribing plano glasses to every child who walks in with a blue cut, then you must prescribe blue cut lenses. Yes,
no, but
that's it.
The debate is that whether blue blocking actually prevents the early onset of ARMD, okay? And which is theory is true, but in practical, we still need to know, because the first smartphones came in 2008 and all these children are no more than 20 years of age right now. So they're too early to get ARMD to prove the theory.
But even the yellow tint in the lenses have disappeared. It's no longer promoted. So
true. So theoretically, yes.
More common question asked is, should I be having the UV filter, whether I should have a scratch resistant coating?
Yes.
These are the common questions that are asked by every parent. Yes.
Exactly. The common, and the answer to that is yes.
Yes.
There is an advantage to those lenses. Whether it is worth the money you are spending or not depends on how much money you have.
Individual, perspective.
So if additional payment for the blue block, you can afford it. Why not? It is an additional advantage.
Correct.
It's like, going for a car with additional features. You can afford it better by it. Like that.
So can we go on?
We can go to the next topic.
Next topic. Yeah.
Yes, please. Yes. Siddharth, you introduce yourself and then start with your topic, please. 99% of people know you, but for the 1% who doesn't know you.
I am Siddharth Kesarwani and I'm a pediatric ophthalmologist. I'll speak about myopia control. Is that enough?
Yeah, that's good.
That's good.
Swapnesh, mute everyone except Siddharth, please.
So my topic is myopia control. I don't know how much time I have because we have only 10 minutes left in the seminar.
You can go on till 7:15, don't worry.
Okay. So I'll try to be fast. Okay, when we everybody knows about myopia progression these days, and that myopia can be controlled, and there are different. But a lot of people have unanswered questions. So my talk will try to answer the unanswered questions rather than answering the known things. So I will not go into history and geography of myopia and all, but I'll just go into the pertinent points which are missed out in most presentations. So we'll start with Amitabh Bachchan of myopia prevention, that is atropine. Okay, today atropine has got level 1 evidence that it can control myopia, and it has to become the standard practice that you should offer myopia control to every child who comes into your office with progressive myopia. Myopia should not be looked upon as a refractive error or an inconvenience that can be treated with a pair of glasses or contact lenses. You should start looking at myopia as a disease. A disease that progresses and it exposes you to risks such as glaucoma and retinal detachment and macular degeneration. And that's why you have to arrest the disease at an early stage. And that's why it becomes important to start thinking differently when you think about myopia control. Myopia control is not an option. It is a need of the hour, because maximum number of children are getting affected, and it is sort of epidemic. In East Asia, the rate of myopia is almost 80-90%. In America, it is around 35-40%. In India, in the urban population, it is close to 25-30%. And overall, it is around 5-15%. Where does atropine act? We all know that atropine is a cycloplegic agent, and we know that reading causes too much reading causes myopia, too much near work causes myopia. So the direct corollary would be atropine inhibits accommodation, and that's how we prevent the prevention of myopia. But that is not true. We need to understand that atropine is also shown to act at extremely low levels, where it does not have any effect on accommodation, and that's why it has to have another method of action. The potential sites of action are in the retina and in the sclera. In the retina, it acts on the amacrine cells in the M1, M4 receptors, and it tries to block the neurochemical cascade that results from defocus. Now, what is defocus? We'll come to that a little bit later. It also is known to affect the growth of the sclera, and thereby, because the common pathway of myopia increase is the increase in axial length, increase in the size of the posterior segment, which it causes increase in the axial length, and that is only the common pathway is the increase in the scleral substance by the thinning and stretching of the sclera. So if you have a drug which can act at that level and it causes the decrease in the extensibility of the sclera and the substances that form the sclera, you will have a control of myopia. Now, most of the level one evidence comes from very highly randomized, controlled, masked trials, double-blinded studies. And there have been plenty of studies right from 1950s, which have shown that atropine is useful in controlling myopia without doubt. Then why this sudden interest in myopia in the last 15, 20 years? Because we have level one evidence which supports it. Atropine in the treatment of myopia study, or the ATOM by Chua et al., was the first study which randomized each subject into one eye getting atropine versus the other eye not getting atropine. And they found a remarkable difference at the end of 2 years. The eye which was getting atropine had absolutely no change in axial length and an increase in myopia by just 0.28 diopters in 2 years. And the eye which was not getting atropine increased by 1.2 diopters. So that firmly established a 1% atropine as an agent that can halt the myopia in its track. But as soon as they stopped the drug, in the next 1 year, there was a big rebound in the eye which was getting atropine 1%. They also found that atropine 1% is not tolerated by many children because of cycloplegia and photophobia. And that's why something else needed to be done. Even before ATOM 1 study, she et al. In 1999 had shown that lower concentrations of atropine are also useful. They had also shown that the effect of atropine in myopia control is dose dependent. And the one more important conclusion they had, that the lower the concentration, the lesser the side effects of cycloplegia or decrease in near vision and photophobia. Taking this into consideration, ATOM 2 was launched, where they compared the efficacy and safety of 0.5, 0.1 and 0.01% of atropine. The majority of the results are tabulated in this particular table. As you can see, at the end of 2 years, the subgroup with 0.5% atropine increased by only 0.3 diopters. In the subgroup which was getting 0.1% atropine, increased by 0.4 diopters. And 0.01% group got increased by 0.5 diopters. Now, as you can see, as you go on in decreasing the concentration of atropine, the effect also becomes less. However, you look at the side effect profile. So they also found that at the end of 2 years, the amplitude of accommodation in the higher concentration group was very less. This child could only accommodate 3.6 diopters, as opposed to somebody who was getting 0.01% atropine, who could accommodate 11.7 diopters. So as you can see, the more concentrated it is, the lesser amount of accommodation you end up with. Also, increase in size of photopic pupil was one of the endpoints. They found that at the end of 2 years, the photopic pupil size in 0.5% group was 3.1 millimeter more than the baseline. So this is not the end pupil size. This is 3.1 mm more than the baseline. Whereas if you see it in 0.01% group, it is only 1 mm more than the baseline. Also, the higher concentration group, almost 70% required progressive addition lenses in the beginning. And in 0.01%, only 6% required progressive addition lenses. There was also a subset of people in all these groups which did not respond to atropine. Almost 4.3% in 0.5% group, almost 6.4% in 0.1%, and almost 10% in 0.1% still continued to increase at a rapid rate in spite of compliance. And an allergy was commonly seen in higher concentrations and not seen in lower concentration. So what ATOM2 showed that all concentrations of atropine are effective. More concentrated the atropine used, more is the effect. The residual amplitude of accommodation is also dose dependent. Higher the concentration, lesser the accommodation. The pupillary size is also dose dependent. Higher the concentration, larger is the pupil in photopic conditions. And that's why you need to come at a dose which has got all the benefits of atropine but does not have the side effects of atropine. So they found that 0.01% had minimal side effects, whereas it had a good effect, even though it was not as strong as 0.5% or 1% in the previous study. They found that almost at the end of 2 years, the myopia only increased by half a diopter as against 1.2 diopters in the placebo arm. So it was able to reduce the progression by almost 50%. Later on, they continued the study for 5 years and then they tabulated the results and they came out with more insights. As we have already discussed, this purple line is the 1% atropine, the red line is the placebo, and these three lines in descending order are the descending order of the concentrations also. The black is 0.5, blue is 0.1, and green is 0.01%. Interesting things you can see in this is, if you leave alone, by the end of 2.5 years, you are at 1.4 diopters of increase from baseline. Whereas, if you are on 0.01% atropine for 5 years, you reach that point at 5 years. So, what you reach in a placebo group in 2.5 years, you reach at 5 years in a atropine group, which is 0.01%. So even 0.01% can slow down their effect to almost 50%. Now, let us understand this graph more in more detail. The first segment is the 2 years of treatment. 2 years of treatment with 1% atropine, 0.5% atropine, 0.1%, 0.01%, and placebo. Next 1 year is the washout period where no drug is given. And the last 2 years is the period where people who are not stable or who have shown a relapse start getting 0.01% atropine again. So as you can see, the effect is dose dependent. The rebound is also dose dependent. So the higher concentration rebounds the most. So the 1% rebounds the maximum. The 0.5% rebounds lesser than that. 0.1% rebounds lesser than that, and 0.01% rebounds very less. And all these treated eyes which were previously, when restarted on 0.01%, have similar effects. So they start again, the rate of progression again starts reducing. So at the end of 5 years, the recommendations that the ATOM data gave was that 0.01% atropine is a cheap, safe, and effective way of controlling myopia. It is usually given in the dose of once daily for 2 years. Children between 6 to 12 years, it is tried and tested in these studies. But in our recommendations, we can start it as less as 5 years also. If the progression is still 0.25 diopter in 1 year, you are better off continuing it. So the question, when to discontinue it? Never discontinue it in less than 2 years. After that, you see whether the rate of progression has come down to less than 0.25 diopter in a year. If yes, then you can discontinue. If after discontinuing, there is a rebound, and then you can start again. Never discontinue suddenly. Always try to taper. So if you're already giving once a day, how do you taper? Start giving it once in 2 days, then once in 3 days, and then once in a week, and then stop. And if the progress is 0.7 diopter, 0.75 diopter in the second year, then it is probably not going to respond. So most of the concentration, lower concentrations, do not start showing their effect at least by 1 year. So you might start therapy and the parent might come after 6 years, it will show an increase. At the end of year, 1 year again, it will show an increase because the maximum effect starts only in the second year for lower concentrations. For higher concentrations like 0.5 and 1%, the effect starts immediately. Like you can see here, the higher concentrations, 1% and 0.5%, effect starts immediately. For lower concentrations, earlier the initial phase, they show a increase only, just like the placebo. And after that, the effect starts. So only after 8 to 12 months of age is when you start seeing the effect. So once you start atropine, you have committed for at least 2 years of treatment. Because if you stop at 1 year, you will never know whether actually atropine has worked or not. So you have to give it at least for 2 years before even you attempt to discontinue and see it. Now, all these the studies were good, but they had some drawbacks. Like the ATOM 2 did not have any placebo arm. They used a historical placebo arm. Plus, there was a big gap between 0.1% atropine and 0.01% atropine. They found that 0.1% is almost a tenfold gap. Plus, they saw that there was a big difference in the effect and the side effect of 0.01% and 0.01% and 0.1%. So a new study with a placebo arm was planned to test the different concentrations between 0.1 and 0.01%. So it had four arms. One is 0.05%, one is 0.025%, one is 0.01%, and one is the placebo arm. This study was called the LAMP study, or low dose atropine in management of progression. This is a very recent study. It has been planned in four stages. The first stage is where four arms are there. In the second stage, the placebo arm will go because it will no longer be ethical to keep the placebo arm. In the third stage, there will be a washout period. And in the fourth stage, there will be a reinstitution period. So the first stage, the phase one results are already there. And it is tabulated in this table. The first stage, they show that, again, the effect of atropine is dose dependent. A 0.05% is almost two times as powerful as 0.01%. Again, the photophobia, increase in pupil size, and reduction in amplitude of accommodation is tolerable in 0.05%. In phase two study, they have shown, again, the same effect continues without the side effect. So in the year 2020, we have a study now, which is a randomized controlled trial, which challenges the position of 0.01% atropine as the undisputed king, and that is 0.05% atropine. So probably in future, we will be using 0.05% atropine instead of 0.01% atropine, which is commercially available right now, because the studies have shown that it has got much more efficacy and the side effects and the quality of life is still tolerable. So this is one of the crux of today's talk, is that the 0.01% atropine may be replaced with 0.05% atropine, at least in Asian and Indian eyes. One of the studies showed in American eyes and Caucasian eyes that they are not able to tolerate anything more than 0.02% atropine. So that may be true for fair skinned, light colored iris children. But this study, which was done in Hong Kong, and is a very well done study. Most of the results in the phase one, phase two are already there. Phase three, phase four is still undergoing, and we will come, we'll get the results later on. So today, 0.05% may challenge 0.01% atropine. Now, this is about the pharmacotherapy with atropine. We will go now to the optical strategies that are possible for myopia control. Now, to understand the optical strategies, you have to understand few concepts. The first concept is any kind of defocus on the eye influences eye growth. In the previous discussion, we were talking about emetropization. Animal studies have shown that if your eye is short, then the then the hyperopic influence will actually make the eyeball grow. So you can induce a refractive error in a growing eye by putting the appropriate lens. So if you create a hyperopic defocus in eye, you can push the eye to become myopic. If you produce a myopic defocus in an eye, then you can make the eye hyperopic. Now this second part, where you can put a negative lens in front, a positive lens in front of an eye and try to make it myopic, is not true in human beings, because otherwise you would reverse all myopia by putting plus lenses. But that doesn't happen. But it is true that defocus influences eye growth. As a corollary, you might say that if you leave the eyeball a little undercorrected, that means you leave the eyeball a little myopic defocus, it will not increase in length. However, this has been studied and it has been proven that undercorrecting myopia does not slow down the progression of myopia. So this tendency of leaving behind half a diopter of myopia or 0.75 diopter of myopia in a newly diagnosed myopic after the age of 5 to 6 years of age is not right. Traditional teaching was like that. You know, you get -3 diopters of myopia, you give him only 2.5 when he comes first. But no longer you should practice this, because studies have shown that this itself can cause progression of myopia. Second concept is that if you treat the defocus itself correctly, that means you create a sharp image on the macula, then there is no defocus at all. So why should the eyeball start growing? But you know that that doesn't happen, because the moment you correct 0.5, you end up with 1. Then you correct 1, you end up with 1.5. So even that doesn't work. So why doesn't it work? So there has to be something else that has to be happening, where the second concept comes, which is called a peripheral defocus influences eye growth. So when you're using a concave lens in the form of glasses or contact lenses or soft contact lenses or RGP lenses, you are creating a sharp focus on the macula. But what about the equator, or why, what about the periphery of the eye? Because of the optics of single vision lenses, that part of myopia gets overcorrected and you create a hyperopic defocus in the periphery. So when you are using a single vision lens, you get complete correction of myopia in the center, but in the periphery, the image shell and the retina shell do not coincide with each other. Thereby, in the periphery, you still have a hyperopic defocus. So it's the summation of the peripheral hyperopic defocus and the central myopic defocus. If it is still hyperopic, that is still stimulus for the eyeball to keep growing in the myopic direction. So how do you tackle this problem? You need lenses which will correct myopia all along the retina, not only on the fovea, leaving hyperopic defocus in the periphery, but all along the retina. So that is where newer kinds of lenses like MyoVision lens by Zeiss and MySight contact lens by Cooper Vision have been tried, where they take care of the central focus and also keep the object in focus on peripheral retina, thereby removing the stimulus for myopia progression. That is the way even ortho-K lenses are supposed to work, because ortho-K lenses, I'll come to the details later, they also take care of this problem. So how does this MyoVision lens or the Zeiss lens or myopia control lenses work? Now you can see from this particular image where a normal lens will correct myopia only in the macula, and it does not correct in the, this is the retinal shell. This is the dotted line is the image shell. So with a normal lens, the image shell is not correcting the entire myopia over the retina. Whereas with a modified lens, the MyoVision lens, the retina, the image shell coincides with the curvature of the oval retina. Thereby, the entire myopia in the periphery and center is taken care of, and that should slow down the progression of myopia. Now, this is an excellent concept, but when it is put to test, it has not shown great promise. Only in a subgroup of children with at least one myopic parent, there was a 30% reduction in progression of myopia, and these lenses are quite costly. Same thing happened with MySight lenses also, which are made by Cooper Vision. These lenses also, they have a distant center lens. That means the center part of the lens focus for distance, and then you have these hyperopic zones, which causes a hyperopic, which takes care of the hyperopic defocus in the periphery. Myopic defocus in the periphery. It does not blur vision, because both of these things are getting projected simultaneously. a exact image and a myopic defocus, which causes the slowdown of myopia, as shown by this study, where 40 children, it was checked, and they found a 30% reduction of myopia progression. Now, all these studies are promising, the lens designs are promising, but we do not have any level one evidence to support it. We do not have large-scale, double-masked, randomized controlled trials like atropine, which can make us prescribe this to our patients, because the myopia progression is retarded by 30%, but it is not across the board. You have a large percent of people who will not respond to this therapy. So as a standalone therapy, maybe it's not that promising, but in addition to atropine, in children who are not responding well to atropine, this can be tried. And we come to ortho-K. Ortho-K is a reverse geometric lens which causes flattening of the central cornea, and it causes heaping up of the mid-peripheral epithelium of the cornea. Now, this not only corrects the central myopia, but it also takes care of the peripheral hyperopic defocus. So that concept which we understood in the beginning, which was that the lens should take care of the central myopia as well as the peripheral hyperopic defocus, can be achieved by an ortho-K lens. Now, several trials, but with small sample size, and like SMART and Crayon have shown almost 30 to 40% decrease in progression of myopia when these lenses were used. What prevents us from using these lenses is, one is the cost. Second, it is quite cumbersome to prescribe these lenses and use these lenses. Third, in a humid and hot climate like ours, you can have more microbial keratitis if you are using ortho-K. So if ortho-K can be prescribed, if it can be used well, and if adequate care is taken in its use, then it is an excellent way of retarding the progression of myopia as per the evidence available to us.
Siddharth, can I just request you to try and summarize? Because what I understand is we would like to leave some time for discussion, and there is a PG session that's going to start after this.
I have three to four more slides, that's it.
Yeah, but if you can do it like in a summarized fashion, because okay. I think the questions will be more relevant then.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'll just have to end it. Yes. Yeah. Sorry. Yes, go ahead.
No problem. So accommodation is also one of the culprits. And in the past, it was thought that accommodation causes increase in IOP, which causes increase in axial length. But then timolol was tried for progression of myopia, but it doesn't work. And accommodation lag, whenever you're doing a lot of near work, but your eye is not able to accommodate properly, it creates a hyperopic defocus, which is compensated by increase in axial length. That's why if accommodation can lead to myopia progression, progressive addition lenses can help in my slowing down the progression of myopia. So two trials, Comet 1 and Comet 2, tested that very concept, that whether an addition of two diopters to your glasses, that is progressive addition lenses, can actually retard the progression of myopia. And they found, yes, statistically they could retard the progression of myopia, but the effect they got was only two diopters in 3 years, which is very less. So given the fact that progressive addition lenses are pretty costly, that amount of retardation of myopia is probably not worth the cost. And the last is a focused stimulation of retina will lead to localized growth of sclera. So if you, in an animal model, if you stimulate only a part of the retina with a particular lens, that means you create a hyperopic defocus in only a part of retina, then only that part of the sclera grows. This shows that there is direct communication between in the retina and the sclera, and there is a biochemical cascade that is triggered by defocus that causes the increase in length of the eye and the remodeling of the sclera. So this particular biochemical cascade is the target of all pharmacotherapy, including atropine and pirenzepine. We have already discussed atropine, so we'll not go into it. So, and the last but not the least, studies have found that a lot of light exposure in children retards myopia, and outdoor sunlight cannot be matched by indoor lights, and that's why every child should spend almost 45 minutes outdoors. So in this graph, we will just compare the relative benefits of myopia control strategies. So this green line is what would happen if you just treat myopia in a traditional way. So you will start at around and zero, and at the age of around 16 years, you might end up with 4.5 diopters of myopia. Whereas if you undercorrect, you will end up with a higher myopia. So never undercorrect. If you use progressive glasses, you might get a half or one diopter less than that. if you use orthokeratology, you will end up with almost half what you would have ended up otherwise. In atropine low concentration, you would end up with almost 1/4 of what you would have ended otherwise. And in atropine 1+, you would probably not increase at all. So combination therapy has also been tried. My take-home message is that myopia is a disease that needs to be slowed down. Myopia control needs to be offered to all. Dilute atropine, myopia control lenses, progressive anti-addition lenses, and ortho-K are used either individually or in combination. And treatment needs to be titrated as per patient response. So you have to use these weapons depending on the patient's background. If his parents are myopic or not, what is his age, what is his rate of progression, what is the myopia he's presenting to you with. And putting all that into perspective, you will decide what is the endpoint of myopia you are aiming at and what is the best possible strategy to get there. Thank you.
Siddharth, before we start off, can you go to the previous slide, combination therapy?
Yeah. So this was one study which was done in 2001 where they tested three groups, single vision lenses, spectacle with multifocal glasses, and spectacle with multifocal glasses and atropine. And they found at the end of 18 months, this was in Taiwan, the increase in axial length in the atropine plus multifocal glasses group was the minimum. So the combination...
There's one question. Yeah. So there's one question, an interesting question which somebody has asked, I think I forget his name. Is in can we start the treatment with 1% and then shift to 0.05% or 0.01%?
Yes, you can do that. You can do that.
Siddharth,
yes.
The combination of the atropine 0.01% along with the outdoors activities supposed to be the best kind of combination for reduction of myopia progression as compared to ortho-K, which is generally about only 40 to 50%. Right. What would you say about this?
So, as I said, see, all these things are acting at different levels. So the ortho-K lens is acting on peripheral defocus. The light is acting on the light dopamine pathway. And the atropine is acting at the retina scleral level. So all these things are going to have an additive effect. So any two will have more effect than one. You know, their combined effect will be more than one.
And what is the maximum period of time a child has had to use atropine?
So,
some people go up to even 11, 12 years also.
Yes. So at the end of the study of the 5-year results of ATOM, they have said that you can use atropine up to even late teens. There is no limit to that. You can use up to 5 years or mid to late teens also. No problem.
Coming to another question asked by Dr. Usha Jori, what is the role of atropine in myopic astigmatism?
Okay, so myopic astigmatism has an axial component also. So atropine is useful in all axial myopia. In these studies, they have ruled out, they have not taken patients who had 1.5 diopter or more of astigmatism, but most of their patients had some astigmatism. So myopic astigmatism is just a form of myopia, if it is not all at the corneal level.
But for special situations like pseudophakics who are, you know, prone to myopia, what is your comment on using it in these special types of patients or very high myopes, you know?
Right. So all these studies have been done in a very controlled environment of school myopia, where the exclusion criteria was pathological myopia and all other kinds of myopia. So as of now, I will not recommend it in these. Although theoretically it may benefit, but we still don't have any evidence for it.
Correct. Very good.
And what would be the ideal age for starting the treatment? Less than 1 year, more than 1 year, 2 years, 3 years?
Okay, so definitely not less than 3 years. That is true. All the studies inclusion criteria is between 6 to 13 years. In our GPOS guidelines, we have given 5 years. So anything about 5 years, it should be okay. Less than that, I would wait unless it is too pressing. I don't think you should start it below 5 years of age right now with the current guidelines.
Dr. Siddharth, I have a question. What about in anisometropia, one eye plano, another eye myopia?
Okay, so you have to show progression. So if your anisometropia is such that it is not changing, then there is no role. But if you are showing progressive myopia in that one eye, then you can start atrophy in that eye.
In that particular eye.
Yeah.
Siddharth, what about the compliance of these patients over a long-term period of usage?
Yeah, so the studies showed that the compliance was pretty high, almost 90% and more. And in private practice also, in our personal experience also, compliance is pretty good.
They're very motivated actually.
Yeah.
Parents are very motivated to do anything to stop myopia progression.
Right. So, Siddharth, what is your first step in a patient who would be labeled as a non-responder? So you have started the 0.01% once at night, and then at the end of, 1 year or in the second year, you find that he's progressing at, a faster rate than or equal to before. What is your next step?
My next step is I make atropine 0.01% twice a day. So that effectively increases the concentration to 0.02%. And I also give them the option of starting to use progressive addition lenses. So that is my second step is actually two steps. So I combine two steps into one. So increase the frequency of my atropine and at the same time give progressive addition lenses.
There are some.
Is there an element of non-compliance in these patients? It could be, no? Means they are not using it properly and that's the reason why.
Yeah, so there we have to take the word of the parents about that.
Usually the parents would know because they would be putting it, and before you change your treatment, they would then come out and tell you that we have not been compliant.
Right. And they're very forthright with it, because the moment you start changing strategy, they will tell you, okay, let me do it properly for 3 months before you change it, doctor.
So what do you do? So to establish progression and to also judge whether our treatment is working, would you rely on cycloplegic refraction? And if so, at what age would you cycloplege? All ages or only younger?
No, again, the protocol for cycloplegia does not change just because a person is on atropine. So if in the first visit you have given cycloplegia the patient and given him full correction, if you see a big jump, then you want to be sure, then only you'll do cycloplegia. If you get a jump which is expected, then I don't do cycloplegia. Suppose if somebody was got minus one and he was reading 6x6 and after 6 months he has got 1.25. 1.25 and he's 6x6 and with one he is 6x9, then there is no need for cycloplegia. But after 6 months suddenly he comes with minus two, then yes, again cycloplegia. So the protocol for cycloplegia remains the same whether you are on atropine or not.
I think you should have one cycloplegia before you start it, so that you at least have some baseline which is reliable.
As I said, that baseline I have established with cycloplegia. So the first one is cycloplegia. Yes.
So now there's a question to you from which says that would the effect? What if there is a patient who's got a posterior staphyloma with a high myopia? Would atropine help in such cases?
Atropine will not harm in such cases. So if you are desperate to try, you can try, but there is no evidence that it is going to help. Because it is not been tried in such eyes.
Okay, the next question is, any particular time of the day where this low-dose myopia works better?
Again, there is no evidence to say whether it is better in the morning or evening.
I think there are some evidence to say that the daytime one is more effective than doing it at night. Is that correct?
I don't know. I'm not aware of that.
And do you follow up these patients by measuring their axial length every time that you really see a progression?
Initially, when I was not sure about myopia control, I was doing that. But now I am pretty convinced that it works, so I don't measure the axial length.
Even at baseline?
Even at baseline. I do not treat them any differently from a person who is not on atropine. Everything is the same. It's just that this person is on atropine, that's it.
Yeah, I think that was a good summary of myopia control and all the options that we have. Does anybody have any experience with ortho care, Karobi ma'am? Any comments on that in our city of Mumbai, at least? Or?
Ortho care is being done by Dr. Yasmin.
Yes.
She does quite a bit of that and she vouches by it. And I don't know what about the side effects and all, because whether infectious keratitis is common or not, I really don't know. But I don't think she's on the panel, right? Otherwise, you could have her experiences, you know. But she does say she's got series where she's got very good results with ortho care.
So I think if you want to, Siddharth, give any summarizing, just the end words of for our people who are, you know, not using it routinely.
I would say that you go by the, when you start using it, go by the guidelines and stick to the guidelines. That means start it only more than 6 years of age. Start it only if you are getting a progression of more than 0.5 in a year. And monitor it initially when you are giving it. And call after prescribing, first follow-up you do after 6 weeks to 2 months and see if the child is tolerating it or using it or not. And then you continue it.
Excellent.
Okay.
I think we have covered all the questions that we could. Some we answered on the chat itself. I think that was a good session. I think I'll pass it over to Swapnish.
Hi, this is Pritam here.
Pritam is here. Yeah. Sorry, Pritam. I didn't see you.
Yeah. So I thank, it was a wonderful webinar today. I thank Siddharth and Prachi for their crisp and informative presentations. And Dr. Karobi, Dr. Ashwin, Dr. Shivram and Dr. Hemlata, thank you for being the discussants here. For the benefit of the other listeners, on Thursday, Swapnish, what are we having on Thursday? It's oculoplasty, right?
Oculoplasty.
Yeah.
So, on Thursday, we are presenting on pigmented lesions of conjunctival.
And what is the other topic?
So, the other topic is yet to be finalized, but probably it would be some interest to the general ophthalmologist only.
Okay. So, on Thursday, the next edition will be on Thursday. That will be on oculoplasty, pigmented lesions of conjunctiva, and the other topic we will announce soon. So, thank you everyone. Have a good evening and bye.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Thanks, Shivram, for staying up. I think it's past midnight for you.
It's just past midnight.
Good night, Shivram.
All right. Okay. Nice meeting you, Shivram. Thanks. Bye. Bye.
Can I end the meeting?
Yeah. Please go ahead and end the meeting, Swapnish.